so much. Thank you so much. Oh my. Yeah, I'm good. Thought there was an extra step. Yeah, you know, this conference wouldn't be possible without Strong Bridges' support. Also, Invitae and PantherRx, the genetic testing, pharmacy arm, the pharmaceutical company. So we're enjoying, you know, a lot of support from our partners, and it's really great. So the next guy up for bids, Todd Bell. Welcome. We introduced Dr. Bell yesterday. He's a pediatric neurologist. Just a pediatrician. That's what I said. Amarillo, Texas. Here you go.
Thanks. Eric, you mind helping me out? Thank you so much. So real quickly, while we're pulling that up, the just one more plug for the University of Florida group that's doing the survey again. We really have a need for research in this field, obviously, and this is just encourage you to participate in that opportunity. I also want to just thank the PPA and the sponsors and Strongbridge for putting this on. Most of all, though, I really want to thank our patients. We have a lot of experts that are here. I'm not one of them, but the expert in you is actually you, and so I appreciate your willingness to let me be able to come and chat with you and be able to learn from you. Right there. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And then how do I turn the... Is this the...
Okay. Thing you can
like. Oh, look at that.
There you go.
All right. So the real quickly, then the I am just a general pediatrician. I'm not a neurologist. I'm actually apparently a Luddite who's trying to make it in a technology-filled world. But that actually clicked over. So I have no financial disclosures. I do have a few disclaimers. The first one being that I'm just a general pediatrician. Without going into the whole long list of why in the world would they invite folks up who aren't neurologists, part of it is the 8:30 slot is actually amateur hour. And so I'm up here for that. But there is actually a lot of overlap between periodic paralysis and some of the things that I do a fair amount of. Just a few other disclaimers. There's virtually no relevant scientific literature to what I'm getting ready to say, especially when we're talking about kids. And I'm not actually going to be speaking directly about periodic paralysis. I'm not going to have anything about the ion channels. It's actually sort of some of those other symptoms that we end up seeing in association with periodic paralysis that I'll be chatting about just a little bit. First thing I would say that in 2017 was the first time I'd come to this conference, and at that time I actually just asked the question how many folks felt like they were hypermobile or used to be hypermobile or were more flexible than their peers, and a significant number of hands went up, and Jake actually was on the front row in that particular conference room, and I look over and he's basically doing the splits there on the front row, and I think it proves the point that there does seem to be, even though we don't have anything in the medical literature really, there does seem to be a link between periodic paralysis and joint hypermobility. And then there's a whole set of other issues that we see with joint hypermobility that may then end up potentially affecting folks who also have periodic paralysis. Then we're going to pick out two of those things in order to be able to assess them. See if I can. No. Okay, can't do behind the back. I'll just actually push on this. So the first thing, a few years ago, I'd looked at the periodic paralysis website, and there's this interesting little disclaimer of some signs and symptoms that had been previously noted that seem to be part of periodic paralysis, but they haven't been formally validated, and then there was a list of those. And then the and that list included things like headaches and heart rhythm issues not necessarily associated with ATS, and attention deficit someone had mentioned earlier, and insensitivity to local anesthetics. And this list that just doesn't fit with what we would expect to have with a ion skeletal muscle ion channel issue. Now, interestingly, the Ehlers-Danlos guidelines that came out in 2017, they'd kind of revised the nomenclature some, in large part because I was finally starting to understand the first set of nomenclature, so they decided they were going to redo it. And when they did that, they actually put a disclaimer in there as well. And it's this actually kind of interesting. It says, many other features described in hypermobile EDS, but not sufficiently specific nor sensitive, blah, blah. And again, it lists through these things of sleep disturbance and fatigue and POTS or orthostatic tachycardia and functional GI issues that someone had mentioned earlier yesterday, I think, dysautonomia, anxiety, and depression. And so I actually got to thinking then about the my own hypermobility clinic that I do. I do a little hypermobility dysautonomia clinic, and we have, it's not certainly not the size of Mayo's dysautonomia clinic, but we have about 400 patients or so that we see in that particular clinic. And again, just sort of the typical things that I see every day in my hypermobile patients that, lo and behold, I also see in my patients who have periodic paralysis. These may be, again, headaches or palpitations. Not that every patient has all these issues, but joint pain, difficulty with sleeping, GI issues, again, anxiety. There's a whole list of things there that just overlap with what I see in the periodic paralysis as well as in the hypermobility patients. And my suspicion is that there's some link there that we just haven't fully defined. And I at least don't understand exactly why it's happened. But when we're thinking about these types of issues, the common thread seems to be the joint hypermobility. And hypermobility just means you're more flexible than your classmates, or I guess maybe your friends at work. I don't know if people at work necessarily compare how flexible they are like sixth graders do. But we use something called the Batten score. This is just a way to be able to assess how flexible somebody is. It is a very imperfect measuring system. If you think about it, any newborn baby you can actually take and tie up into a pretzel, because that's just how newborn babies are built. You shouldn't do that, actually, because CPS gets involved. But but all babies are really flexible. Most 90-year-olds are not, right? So we know that there's changes in flexibility that occur with time. We also know that there's changes in flexibility that occur with injury. So if I break my hip, then when I get back on my feet and off the walker, I'm not going to be as flexible as I was perhaps before. We also know that people can actively change their degree of flexibility. So someone does yoga for a long period of time, they're going to be more flexible than someone who's not. But in general, the idea is that hypermobility, or this increased flexibility, seems to be associated with this slew of other symptoms. Now, the hypermobility itself is not necessarily a problem or an issue. There's undoubtedly many, many people who work at a circus that are incredibly flexible and have no other symptoms. And I occasionally will get a referral where I have an asymptomatic hypermobile patient that some physician just wanted me to look at and assess whether anything needs to be done. And it's like, well, if the kid doesn't have any symptoms, I don't think I'd do anything. But when we think about the hypermobility, you can think about it just being on a bell curve, similar to some people are taller than others, some people are heavier than others. Everything in biology is on a bell curve. Those folks who are more flexible than others, though, tend to be ones who have some of these other symptoms, regardless of whether they have periodic paralysis. So there are other hypermobility syndromes besides the Ehlers-Danlos. We're not going to go through those, but just suffice it to say that there's a lot of different things or syndromes that are associated with hypermobility, and there's also a lot of symptoms that are associated with hypermobility that are noted in the literature, that we have evidence that seems to suggest that this is a true association, and we just don't have a great explanation for. And so some of these chronic fatigue, or CFSME now, I think is the correct term, Chiari malformations, eosinophilia of different flavors, eosinophilic esophagitis, for example. I'd point out someone had mentioned or had asked me about mast cell issues yesterday, anxiety, I think we talked about yesterday. We really don't know why these associations are there, but they just seem to occur more frequently in some patients who have hypermobility. So how common is hypermobility and periodic paralysis? I don't think we have any idea. There's, as far as I'm aware, there's no data there's no formal surveys. We're actually kind of working on a little way to be able to assess that. It's one of the struggles with rare diseases is sometimes it's difficult to get enough patients together in the same place to be able to make assessments like that. And how is hypermobility associated with this laundry list of non-channel mutation symptoms that that we see? And I think there's sort of two ways potentially that hypermobility is associated with symptoms. One of them is direct effects. So if I'm hypermobile and I dislocate my shoulder and I'm going to be at increased risk of dislocation because of my hypermobility, then that's a direct effect of the excess laxity of the collagen that makes up the joint. All right, so that's a direct effect. We see that bleeding and bruising is more common in folks who are hypermobile. And when we see that, we actually think, and I don't know if this is entirely correct, but we think that what's happening is that we have more difficulty with platelet activation when the platelet is exposed to collagen after you have a ruptured blood vessel or a bruise or a cut. The headache may be a direct effect with either vascular spasm related to the collagen itself or potentially alterations in cervical spine stability. But again, we're not exactly sure, but there are these direct effects. And then there's this whole slew of indirect effects that somehow seem to have as a central point the functioning or regulation of the autonomic nervous system. And this is actually kind of what first got me interested, or first brought PP actually to my attention, was I kept having patients coming into my hypermobility dysautonomia clinic who clearly had autonomic regulation issues from whatever reason that was. They were clearly hypermobile, and they also had the periodic paralysis. And we don't know for sure what the that association with the or how that association with the autonomic regulation actually occurs. But really briefly, the dysautonomia or this dysregulation of the autonomic nervous system, we'll just kind of talk through that very briefly. Basically, if we think about the brain, there's as a layperson, there's two things that the brain does. There's things that are under our conscious control. So if I want to pick my nose, I tell my elbow to bend and my finger to go up, and I'm on camera, so I'm not going to finish the demonstration, but all of that is under my conscious control. It's what I'm thinking and telling my body to do. But we also have a whole list of things that are not under our conscious control. They just happen automatically as a response to whatever's going on around us, as the body responds and adapts and compensates for whatever's happening. So if I stand up, my body has to make some adjustments to be able to account for the changes in gravity. If a bear walked into the room, we would certainly question how good security was here, but we would also probably have a lot of physiologic changes to the body that would happen just because the bear came into the room. My pupils may get larger, I might sweat differently than I otherwise would, my belly may feel funny, I might have to go pee. All of those things are not things that I'm telling my body to do. They're a normal physiologic response to a perceived threat or a stressor. Now, I think it's also worth noting that a bear walking into the room has not done anything to me, right? So I haven't been mauled by the bear. I haven't, the bear hasn't made me run yet. It's not chasing me with a chainsaw. But merely the presence of the bear being there starts to elicit changes in my physiology. So we can have both physical stressors, like being mauled by a bear, and we can also have psychological stressors, like being just having a bear unexpectedly walk in the room, which both result in the activation of that autonomic nervous system, which then causes a series of changes in the body. So if I have one of my patients who has dysautonomia, and the most common type in children that we see with hypermobility is actually something called POTS, or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. It's basically a child may be fine when they lay down, they stand up, and all of a sudden their body, instead of making a small adjustment to that autonomic nervous system or the sympathetic nervous system, the body acts like a bear just walked into the room. all of a sudden the child's pupils get big, and they may sweat differently, and their belly may feel funny, and they may have their heart rate's going to go up, which is actually kind of how we define POTS itself. But all of those are part of that autonomic nervous system regulation that seems to be an issue in patients who have hypermobility. And again, it can be any sort of psychological or physical stressor that can trigger that. So how does hypermobility connect with dysautonomia? And again, we don't know. There are a lot of hypotheses that are out there. There's very little data to back these up. We talk sometimes about vascular pooling. Depending on how misogynistic your physician is, depends on where they say that the pooling is occurring. But the but again, we just don't have a lot of great data to say that that's it. Maybe it is part of the issue. Vascular tone regulation certainly seems to be part of the issue, but in a way, that actually is what dysautonomia is. It doesn't necessarily tell us why it happens more in hypermobility. Alterations in autonomic receptor sensitivity, where we have issues with, for example, carotid sinus sensitivity, and where maybe things are overly sensitive or under-sensitive. But the fact is, we just don't know. I actually have my own little pet hypothesis, and without going into it too much, it's that the hypermobility actually causes some deformative strain on autonomic nerves. We do actually have a little bit of data. I usually, one more disclaimer here, I usually don't actually show these photos because I don't know what to tell you to do with them. But I actually had two folks who I had talked with yesterday that this kind of sort of came up. So I'm just going to throw out a picture or two just to show what I'm talking about. This is a 16-year-old that got referred to me for syncope, and I'm gonna, does that make it? Nope. Is there any way to do a line? Hey, look at that, sorry. Everybody's familiar with what a Luddite is. If not, it's worth Googling. It perfectly describes me, but it's just someone who's not particularly adept at nor enjoys technology. So laser pointers are not necessarily, I realize that's not like a 2019 thing, that they've been around for a while, but I'm still struggling with those. This is probably going to be difficult for you to see, but the trust me, that right up here we see the connection between the first and second cervical vertebra. So the first vertebra is kind of here on each side. The first vertebra is like a donut. If you cut a donut in half and looked at it end on, you would see both sides of the donut. And so that's kind of what we see here on the side of this bone. Now this bone sticking up here is part of the second cervical vertebra, okay, and that little bone there is called the den. So this is a 16-year-old who has issues with passing out. It's West Texas, so he mainly passes out when he's out on a horse. He works on a ranch. And he's also been bitten by rattlesnakes 3 times, and I'm not sure if that has anything to do with it. But the he keeps falling into cactuses when he passes out on his horse, and so his parents got tired of having to pull cactus barbs out. So somebody had referred him over to me, and what you can see is that the dens is just perfectly balanced between those two lateral masses. And that's normal in this picture. I should have also said, here's eyes are going to be up here. There's teeth right here. This patient's basically has their mouth open looking at the camera. Now, when the child tilts his head to the side, everything stays the same. There's no change or difference, and that's actually normal. So this is a 16-year-old who passes out. He has no symptoms of dysautonomia. He does not have periodic paralysis. He just passes out. And the reason he passes out, actually, is because he's also a type 1 diabetic, and he's really bad about managing his blood sugars. And so when he goes out riding the horse early in the morning out on the ranch, he hadn't eaten breakfast, his insulin pump's already shifted, he just gets hypoglycemic. Now, we compare that, though, with a, this is actually a actually also a 16-year-old who got referred over to me, who has periodic paralysis, And also has issues with autonomic regulation. So the gets dizzy when she stands up, has had a brief episode of fainting in the past with standing, has some issues with some GI things. And this young lady, again, open mouth right here. We've got the first cervical vertebra there, those two halves of the donut, and right in between, pretty well balanced there, is the dens, that little thumb of bone, and the second cervical vertebra. Now, when she tilts her head to the side, though, look what happened. The first cervical vertebra kind of shifts over to the side. Compared to where that dens is, where that thumb of bone is. When we go back to the child who passes out because of his blood sugar, we see that the den stays right in the middle of those two. And I realize this is hard to see. But the point of it is that I think that at least in some of these patients, we may have some strain on those nerves where it affects the way that the nerves function. And that's a whole different question or discussion about why that would be. But this is exactly what I see in my hypermobility dysautonomia patients, and also happens to be what I see in the my patients who have periodic paralysis and autonomic symptoms. It's kind of a difficult X-ray to get sometimes. It's especially in younger children, it's hard to get their head exactly positioned. But this is what I see with dysautonomia and hypermobility, and interestingly is not what I see when we have patients who have hypermobility and no dysautonomia. They tend to look like the kiddo who has the horse issue that passes out when because of his blood sugar and does not have dysautonomia. All right, so second speculation alert. So one hypothesis then about how this connects with dysautonomia, one hypothesis would be, hey, some patients have a completely unrelated hypermobility. The hypermobility is associated with dysautonomia. The dysautonomia then, because of the sympathetic activation, actually does affect the potassium. And so when we have difficulties regulating the autonomic nervous system, we end up with additional fluctuations in the potassium that we wouldn't see in a patient who has periodic paralysis but does not have the dysautonomia. And I think that there probably is some truth to that. And I definitely have patients that will have more periodic paralysis symptoms or episodes when they're having more difficulty with regulating their periodic paralysis. Now, I suppose it's also possible, at least, that there are maybe some atypical periodic paralysis patients who don't actually have a nerve channelopathy, a muscle channelopathy, but rather have actually direct effect on the nerves. Now, that brings up the whole question of why do they then respond to potassium like someone who has the channelopathy? And the short answer is I don't know. These are just hypotheses. But you can think of an extreme example. I remember a young lady that I'd seen who actually had her first cervical vertebra had slid off the second cervical vertebra, and whenever she'd turn her head to the side, something called bow hunter syndrome. And when she would do that then, she would lose the function of her arms. And within about 30 or 45 minutes, it would come back. Now, this was clearly demonstrated on a CT scan, so there wasn't any question that it was related to the first vertebra. It was not any kind of periodic paralysis, but could we have some more more subtle presentation of the same kind of thing in some patients? All that is just speculation. I would like to, and I'm probably running over on time. I apologize. But I did want... Oh, I thought they cut off my mic because I was talking too long. I did want to briefly run through two things that I think are common, at least in hypermobility, and then maybe applicable to some people with periodic paralysis. So the first thing is, what do we do about joint pain? Joint pain is not a huge issue in the really young kids who have hypermobility. As they get older, it becomes more of an issue. When I talk with adults who have hypermobility, joint pain is a big problem oftentimes. Now, again, people can be hypermobile, not have any symptoms. But those who do have symptoms, joint pain tends to be pretty common. So there's sort of two ways that we can damage a joint when we have lax ligaments. One of them is that we can actually just develop a little bit of microtrauma to the articular surface of the joint. As you start walking, you get sort of poor biomechanics because there's just more wobble in the joint, and that wobble then causes issues. People will unconsciously adjust their what they're doing by compensating with other joints, and as they do that, then we potentially have stress on other joints as well. The other thing that can happen is sort of macro trauma. So you can have something dramatic, like you dislocate your shoulder or your hip or something like that. And when that happens, you get a lot of stretch on those ligaments. And that stretch on those ligaments then causes the ligaments to be stretchier. And then you have more risk or more issues with the with dislocations or macro trauma occurring again. So in our practice, at least, what we typically do is we first of all tell people to avoid pole vaulting and heading soccer balls and things like that. The second thing is, but we want kids to be kids. We want adults to be adults. The second thing that we try to do is we try to make sure that the patients are continually keeping muscle tone as best they can. Now, obviously, we have to be somewhat cautious in our patients with periodic paralysis. We don't want them going out and necessarily running a marathon if they're not if they haven't built up and worked up to that. But I think that the Gabe's bicycle ride is a good example of how if you have periodic paralysis, you may still have a lot of exercise capacity. The second thing that we try to do is we try to make sure that we're giving joints time to heal if they get injured. And then the third thing is physical therapy. Now, I know with physical therapy, we got to, again, be cautious because your physical therapist needs to know something not just about the joint but also about periodic paralysis. We don't want to be overstrenuously exercising when you go to the physical therapist. If the PT's first thing is, well, I want you to run in place for 5 minutes, that may not be the right physical therapist to go to. But when we're thinking about PT, it's a kind of an essential part of joint management, of hypermobility, because it allows us to be able to use the muscle itself to stabilize the joint. When we use orthotics, when we put a brace on, the problem is the muscles tend to get weaker the longer we wear the brace, which means when you take the brace off, the joint is even more lax and unstable than what it was before. So there's a balance there of trying to make sure that we keep the physical therapy and keep the muscle strength without causing more damage to the joint. So what we usually do is for short what I call muscular joints, we typically do a short course of immobilization. So if someone dislocates their shoulder or they're having a lot of problems, we may put the shoulder in we may put them in a sling for a few days, but then we want to be able to rebuild the strength around that muscle. We don't want to, I don't like my patients to have a knee brace on for weeks on at the end because we end up losing a lot of muscle. If we have ligamentous joints like the fingers, the ankles sometimes, those are joints that we really have to start looking at orthotics. So if I have a patient who can't write in school because of pain in the fingers, then I'll start looking at like ring splints, for example, because it's really difficult to be able to use therapy to fix hypermobility of a joint that doesn't have a lot of muscle around it. Very briefly, we're just going to kind of fly through the dysautonomia as well. Eric, any idea how long I've got on time? Am I already like way past? Okay, all right. Flying through real quickly. Dysautonomia. So there's, bear in mind that dysautonomia is not really what it is in the literature, where it's a chronic stable thing. That happens with diabetes. With hypermobility, dysautonomia tends to be dynamic. What we usually look at is trying to attenuate the way the sympathetic nervous system responds. There's a few ways we can use beta blockers. I prefer non-cardiac selective beta blockers. We have to be a little cautious. It can bump up your potassium a little bit. We can use clonidine or guanfacine. These are also some things that blunt the autonomic response a little bit. There's midodrine, which is a peripheral vasoconstrictor. There's one that called ivabradine, which there's a little bit of early promising data specific to POTS. We do have to be a little bit cautious with QT prolongation. And then there's non-pharmacologic things. My non-PP patients, I tell them to just drink lots of Gatorade. Obviously, that doesn't work with my PP patients. But we do want folks to hydrate. We use, this is an example of a cooling vest. This is one of my patients who she actually is able to slide it on underneath her regular clothes because for her, excessive heat is really a trigger for fatigue and some of her dizziness. We have different types of therapies, cognitive behavioral therapy, because remember, it's not just the physiologic triggers, but also the psychologic triggers that can result in autonomic issues. And then there's some data on some early data on vagal nerve stimulation, not necessarily specific to dysautonomia, but rather for headaches and some of the other management. So very briefly then, the autonomic regulation issues seem to be really common in joint hypermobility syndromes. Hypermobility seems to be common in periodic paralysis. There are some therapies that may be helpful in treating some of those symptoms that we see related to hypermobility. And frankly, there's a lack of scientific data or evidence in the literature to be able to guide us. So there is a lot of just trial and error that occurs with this, like we see in a lot of rare diseases. With that and the fact that I'm probably like 20 minutes over, I'm going to shut it down. And if we have any time for questions, I'll be happy to take those. But that's going to be up to the big bosses about whether we need to move on.
We have time for a couple of questions. Then I think we should take a small break, have Dr. Cannon, and then go to lunch a little late.
Hello. Everybody talks about avoiding triggers and foods that are beneficial foods to avoid. Because it took so many years to get my daughter to you to get diagnosed, I ended up looking into a lot of nutritional approaches to help her in the meantime. And one of the things, being hypokalemic, I don't think it would be the same for hyperkalemic, but for hypokalemic was concentrated fruits and vegetables. And there have been about a half dozen other people that have tried the same approach and had the same benefit. Is there, I mean, I know it's a nutrigenomic thing. So is there any interest in the doctors talking about periodic paralysis to look at the nutritional approach? Because it didn't just, she's also hypermobile, it didn't just drastically reduce her periodic paralysis symptoms, it also firmed up her joints. She stopped needing wrist braces and ankle braces.
So I think that's a really great question. And again, I would plead ignorance and I'm tempted to throw the mic back actually to Cannon again. But I do think that the, first of all, there's a lot that we just don't understand. And I do think that when we look at autonomic regulation, we know that yet another one of those things that the autonomic nervous system is involved in is, for example, glucose homeostasis. And so when we have a kid on a typical American diet, that causes a lot of potential issues with, your kid goes and eats half a dozen donuts and the blood sugar goes up, then the blood sugar comes down. Those things result in autonomic triggers. And so I think that having some sort of consistent, we at least have good data that some sort of consistent diet and a healthy diet makes a big difference in autonomic control. I think that the other part is, and this is certainly getting out of my area of expertise, but there's at least some things that suggest that inflammation itself may actually affect ligament laxity. So we actually designed a study where we took a group of mice and we give half the mice gingivitis. We basically took their toothbrushes away. And then the other half of the mice, we just did, I guess we let them have their toothbrushes. But anyhow, so the gingivitis in mice, there's a model there for inflammation. And then what we were wanting to do was actually be able to see, was there a difference or an effect on ACL laxity? So in the joint laxity in the knee. And we kind of hit a snag because it turns out a mouse ACL is very, very small, and I wasn't able to get it actually clamped into my tensometer, and finally my lab tech in disgust moved on to a different project. But the thought is, or there is biological plausibility, that if you do something that affects inflammation, then you may actually be able to affect ligament laxity as well. And we see that oftentimes in the kids who are hypermobile and dysautonomic, they will have some fluctuations in how stable their knees are, how stable their ankles are. And I don't think it can be explained just by, well, when did they have their last dislocation? There's something more to it there that we just don't know. And again, you know, how do we address that? I don't know. There is, I think, somewhat early, but a growing body of evidence that nutrition certainly can affect systemic inflammation. Maybe that's part of that, but I'm just speculating. And Wendy, email me what you need, and I promise I'm going to read my email. So,
all right, we'll do one more.
Hi. I don't find myself very flexible at all. I mean, even as a child, I wasn't like doing back bends like my friends could do them, and I, you know, can't bend my thumb backwards. I can't do weird things like that. But I do have a big problem with my bones frequently shifting out of place in several different locations, you know, hips, back, neck, knees, shoulders, ribs. Had ribs out of place several times. I mean, is that a form of that, or is it two different things?
I think so. So, again, I think this also speaks to the fact that Baton score that I showed is a very, very imperfect scoring system. So, as a matter of fact, the patient whose neck X-ray I showed that has periodic paralysis, her Baton score was actually 5. Now, she's a teenager, so that's like right on the edge. But she's not like someone who would go and be able to apply to work at a circus or do trapeze work or be a professional gymnast. So the degree of hypermobility that we usually think of, well, someone's really flexible or they're not, doesn't seem to always correlate with symptoms that people are having. So someone may have no real flexibility in, let's say, their fingers, and so their Baton score is normal, and they don't consider themselves to be double jointed, but lo and behold, they're always popping their shoulders out of place, or they may have, you know, mild scoliosis with an unusual age of onset. And those are also, I guess, sort of subtle findings that we may have change in, or excessive movement in at least some of those joints, but without it being in all of the joints. And I don't think we have any great explanation or descriptor to be able to say how do we tease that out, short of just working with symptoms. What I would say is if you're feeling subluxation, if you're feeling that things are popping and they're hurting and they're then I would at least consider working with a physical therapist to see can you find a way to be able to train those muscles to better protect those particular joints that are that are a problem for you, because it doesn't tend to be something that when we have that excess movement, the excess movement tends to beget additional excess movement. So again, if it's popping out of place, it would likely be something that could be intervened on, and may be able to help some with the symptoms that you're having.
Thank you.
All right, great. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Bell.